Hello, beloved in Christ. This is Humphrey. Tonight we are here to have a discourse with you, to share one or two issues that bothers many in the Christendom. Now we have a topical issue that we want to dilate and expatiate so that you will get a clear-cut understanding of why you are here on earth. This evening, I have with you and have with me here one of our renowned elder, Elder Andrew, to talk with us our raised topical issue. The one that called you, do you really know him? Who is he to you? So this is the issue we have been raised and we are bringing it on your table. Good evening. My name is Humphrey. I'm here with Elder Andrew. Elder, you are warmly welcome.
Thank you. God bless you.
God bless you too. I hope everything is fine.
By the grace. Yeah. Doing fine. Thank you.
We thank God. It has been a topical issue in the minds of many people, most especially those in the Christian fraternity, whether or not they understand the one that called them is another issue. If I may ask, who is Jesus Christ?
I use this opportunity to greet all your viewers and your listeners. God bless you for inviting me on this topic. I'm very happy. It's not me who is going to give the answers, but the Bible says if we rely on the Spirit of God, he will speak to us. So allow the Holy Spirit to do the answering.
Yeah.
I'm just a vessel.
Thank you.
Now, to answer the question who Jesus is, in simple terms, I would say Jesus is God who became a man to save man.
Jesus is God
who became a man to save man.
Can you expatiate it further?
Yes.
So that we would get the clear-cut understanding.
Okay. Now, it all began from the beginning. When you say beginning, you're talking about Genesis.
Yeah.
When God made everything, the Bible says he gave a commandment to Adam that he was freely to eat everything in the garden, but that particular tree he shouldn't touch or eat the fruit of it. The day he eats it, he will surely die. That word surely means God will make sure death, that was there, who has no life in it, will be alive, will get life through sin to kill Adam.
Mm-hmm.
So Adam did not believe in God. He disobeyed, and the Bible says he rebelled against God. Therefore, man had to die.
So, Elder, if my memory serves me right, you said, God said, the day you eat this particular fruit,
you will die. That's right.
It means death was with Adam or what? Or death was in the fruit.
Now, many people think Satan created death, but that's not right. When God made everything, the sun, the moon, the stars, everything was there, nice. God said, it is good. When God was speaking to Adam in chapter 2 of Genesis, Satan was not there. The devil was in there. Lucifer was in there. He said, the day you eat the fruit, you shall surely die. And God is a God, when he speaks, he creates. So that time, death was created, but without life. So I can say, death was created dead. He had no power to function. Let me bring it to normal level. Take a bottle, for example. Can a bottle cut you if it is not broken? No. But the moment a bottle is broken, it gets the power to cut. So God told Adam, the day you eat, you shall die. Death was existence. But it was dead. There was no life in it. It continued for years. The thing we are talking about in Genesis 2 is no one day thing. It took tens of years, hundreds of years. But until that day, when Adam thought, let me eat, he did it. And the moment he did, death that was created already, that had no power or life in it, got power or life from the sin Adam committed. And he rose up and he killed
Amazing.
Adam. So Adam chose to be killed. God did not kill Adam. Satan did not kill Adam. Adam chose to be killed by death.
So what you are trying to say is that if Adam hadn't failed to act against the will of God, he would not die.
No, no way.
So it was because of Adam's action that produced the power to kill Adam.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And the power that death got, he did not get it from Adam directly. He got it from sin. Sin has the power to give to death, and death will kill.
Oh, okay. So when Adam flouted or sinned against God, then death also got power.
Power from the sin. And he killed him. So, and God said, you see, I told you, so the day you eat, you shall surely die.
To the day he ate, and death also arose.
And he killed.
And killed. So God did not kill Adam.
No.
But Adam
chose to be killed by death.
Oh my. That is wonderful. Viewers, that is interesting. How death came about and how Adam was killed by death. Not God, but his action and inaction. So, Elder, if I may ask, what is sin? What is sin?
Sin in the Hebrew word means rebellion. To rebel against the known will of God. That is sin. In the whole Bible, it talks about Jesus Christ dying for the sin of the world. Some manuscripts use sins, but it's actually one sin. That's to rebel against the known will of God. That is sin.
And another school of thought also defines sins as Satan in nature. That Satan always exhibits himself using what God has created. To also violate or flout what God has laid down as his principle. So it means that when a person sins, then death comes in.
Yes.
Can you elaborate on that for us?
Yes. When God told Adam, the day you eat, you shall surely die, Adam was unknown to death. He had never experienced death before. So come to our dispensation now. When God was announcing death, Adam thought, what is it actually?
Yeah.
I see everything that God has made, the trees, the rivers, everything, I see them. But how does death look like? Now, the moment he experienced it, he died in three different stages.
Before you go, before you give us the three categories of death, and then you've given us the definition of death already. So,
of sin.
What is death? Before you give us the three categories of death, what is death?
The category defines death actually in its totality.
Okay.
Because death is number one. When God's spirit leaves a man, a man can be walking down the street, he got a suit on, Gucci, Gabanchi, whatever the designer name might be, he looks very, very splendid. But if that person doesn't have God's spirit, he's dead. He's a walking dead. Take somebody like Usain Bolt. Take somebody like the well-known athlete, a very famous person. If that person doesn't have God's spirit inside of him, he's dead. Madam Well or Miss Well, she can be as beautiful as whoever. But if God's spirit is not in the person, he's also walking dead. Adam was created by God in Genesis. God breathed into him. The Bible says he's become a living soul. He was alive. God was alive in him. God's spirit was inside of him. But the moment he transgressed or he missed the mark, that is sin.
That
time, God's spirit left him. And when you read further on Genesis, the Bible says he lived about 930 years. But come to think of it, the Bible says he is dead.
Elder, to cut you, not to interfere you also, Adam lived 930 years. And you are telling us and my viewers that he died. How come?
He was a living dead because he didn't have God's spirit. The moment he rebelled against God, God is a God who can't stay with sin. The Bible says that our body is God's temple. Mm-hmm. His spirit lives within us. Now, the moment you rebel against him, you are thriving. Yeah. It's like putting fire and water in the same pot. It cannot work. So God's spirit must leave him. The moment God's spirit departed from Adam, that instant he was dead.
So though you are living,
but you are dead.
Still you're dead.
So let me go in deeper here.
Yeah.
So all the years that Adam spent after rebellion was a dead years. And all that time, you and I, we were in his loins.
Yeah.
So his death affected everything inside of him. So Genesis chapter 5 says, everything that God made produced after his own kind. So Adam being dead produced after his own kind. His children were dead. All the children were dead. So dead people can produce dead people. Who can produce dead people? So in actual fact, a baby who is born today is dead to God.
That Why? Is wonderful.
He is born under the lineage of Adam's death. That's why this day Jesus said you need to be born again. That's where the born again come from. Because you are born dead. So if you want to be alive, be born again. That's the first stage of death.
Yeah.
The second stage of death is when you depart from God's presence. You are dead. The second stage. See all the crime going on around. Mm-hmm. Shooting and killing. Raping. Somebody can even rape his own mother.
Yeah.
Anybody who is in God's presence will never do those things.
Yeah.
All those crimes going on is just because man has left God's presence. If you are dead, you do stupid things. Genesis, God said, let us make man in our own image. Let them have dominion.
Mm-hmm.
The word dominion means let them have mastery.
Yeah.
Divine authority over everything, over leaves. But now go to Colombia. Go to Cuba. What's killing them? Cocaine from leaves. It's ruling man. Because man is dead. If you are dead and somebody kick you, you don't even feel it.
Yeah.
The things that God says we should have dominion on, those things are having dominion over us. Cocaine can let somebody be sleepless, homeless, out on the street. A girl has to be inject cocaine things in his system, destroy his body. Why? He's dead already. So if a common leaf, very sad, a common leaf, tobacco, causing you cancer, your throat, your coughing, cigarette, is having power over you.
Yeah.
And a human being, you don't have a sense to reason, that tells you you are dead.
So if the presence of God leaves you,
you are
if
dead.
The spirit of God leaves you,
you are dead.
You are dead. And then coming to the presence, it means that you act not in accordance with what God says we should act
or should do. Can a sleeping person drink water?
No.
If you are asleep, you are oblivious of everything that happens around your surroundings. That's how dead is. If you are dead, you are not conscious of the things you do. If you leave God's, let's come home. I have a son. If I want my son to copy the things I do, enjoy my life, he stay close to me.
Yeah.
The moment he become a vagabond and he walks away, he doesn't feel me. That's how we become. The moment Adam sinned, the Bible says God kicked him out of the garden. He was there for the second grade.
Yeah.
Nothing perfect that was able, he was able to enjoy in the garden anymore. That garden of Eden, that is an atmosphere. Next time I will elaborate much more on the Eden.
All right.
So the moment Adam left that God's presence, he was there to the second grade. The last grade is after 930 years, his own human spirit left his body. That time you become lifeless. You become rotten.
Yeah.
And you go back to the earth where you came from. So death to God is three stages. And the most shocking one and painful one is when God's spirit leaves you.
We will come to that, but let's tackle the last category of death.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The last category of death is when man's spirit leaves him. Nobody will come to you and take your spirit away from you. Automatically, you grow old. If you are lucky, then you die. But when God told Adam, curse is a ground for you because of what it is you did, or death has come to you, or you will die. That time, diabetes was given the power.
Wow.
Blood pressure was given the power.
Yeah.
All sickness you can name off, they were all given the power because they are the tentacles of death. So death can send diabetes to you, kidney failure to you, Go and bring him, because I want your spirit to leave your body. So any sickness that I want, I can send it to you so that it will cause your spirit to leave your body, then you die finally. But it's very pathetic to die the first stage, the second stage, you have another chance.
I was even about to ask, apart from these three categories you've elaborated, which one of these that God shows much concern about?
God shows much concern about the first one, when his spirit leaves you.
Mm-hmm.
So he gives another chance. That even though my spirit have left you, don't leave my presence. That's why we repent.
Mm-hmm.
So when Jesus came, he said, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Mm-hmm. Repent means have a change of mind. Even though you have rebelled against me, my spirit have left you, but when you have a change of mind, I will come back to you again.
Mm-hmm.
So if that one, you miss it. Secondly, you don't even attend church service.
Mm-hmm.
You don't even get closer to God. Yeah? That means you are getting away as far as you can from him. You are depleting gradually. And then finally, your spirit leaves your body, become comatose,
mm-hmm.
lifeless, and that's the end of it.
I love that. So that is our Elder Andrew dilating and expanding the gospel, the teachings of Christ about death, about sin, about what Adam did and what death also did to Adam. Elder, with all these elaborations, can you also say that these three categories of death has entered today's Christians?
Yes. The fact that we come to church every Sunday doesn't mean we are Christians. Most of the time, people, they categorize themselves in that definition. But the Bible says that they were first called Christians in Antioch.
Mm-hmm.
God has already prophesied through Isaiah that a time will come that the Gentiles will give you name.
Mm-hmm.
And it was fulfilled.
Yeah.
Then when Christ came, the followers of them saw how they behave, saw how their lifestyle was. These people, they behave like Christ. So Christians for that matter. So come to think of it, do the people we see here on Sundays, when you meet them on Tuesday on the street, are they the same people?
Mm-hmm.
Are their lifestyle like Christ?
Mm-hmm.
Christ said, if one slaps you here,
mm-hmm.
turn the other cheek.
Mm-hmm.
Apply that. Would they respond to it?
Mm-hmm.
So, Christians nowadays, it's not as how we see them.
Yeah.
Many of us, we don't live in accordance with the definition given unto us or the names tagged unto us.
Yeah.
Because God's Spirit has left us.
Left us.
We are just walking and dressing with our handbags and with our suits on. Meanwhile, God's presence, His Spirit, is not within us. But the one who is alive in Christ, alive, he will go according to God's principles and ordinances. You see that person's life will reflect. He doesn't even have to tell you, I'm a Christian. The way he converses, the way he speaks, his dressing even, the way he responds to timing in his working place. The boss says, be here at 8 o'clock, he'll be there 7:45. The boss says, we close at 5 o'clock, he'll leave the workplace at 10 minutes after 5. He doesn't steal from the boss's time.
Mm-hmm.
But here we are, we see we are Christians. You give an instruction to your colleague, when you go and I'm not there, collect my time for me. Are you not stealing?
Mm-hmm.
Are you not rebelling against God's no will?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So most of us, we are dead Christians. Because if the Spirit of God really lives in you, He will prompt you certain things you do. He'll prompt you. Because you'll not be alone, you'll feel it.
Yeah. Elder, I'm still curious about the first and the second elements of the death. For instance, when God's Spirit departs from you, and then when man departs from the presence of God, can a pastor or a church officer, leader, cease to experience this? I don't know whether you understand.
Yes.
The question.
Yes. It happens, and it's happening right now.
Mm-hmm.
That most so-called pastors, in the beginning, God calls them.
Mm-hmm.
And they use this slogan that the gift of God is irrevocable.
Mm-hmm.
That means when God calls you, He gives you a gift. He doesn't take it back. Fair enough. So after they have a gift of healing, for example, they raise their shoulders pride set in. The moment God sees that pride has set in, His Spirit will warn you several times. And the Holy Spirit is a gentle spirit. He wouldn't force you. He would just leave. Then you are there alone, dead. So the way you operate, you will not operate or function that anymore. So you then solicit outside help. That's where they go to see this Manhattan spirit and spirit from dead, and they wear rings and handkerchiefs in their pocket, performing signs and wonders. So that the general public will see that this pastor is very, very sharp spiritually. But he himself knows that he isn't.
He's not operating from the true spirit of God.
That's it. He'll be preaching and shout, but he's dead. The congregation see him, pastor, preach on, powerful pastor, man of God, but he's dead to God.
Then it's so serious that many congregations are sitting under the feet of
dead pastors.
Dead pastors.
Yeah.
Very, very amazing.
Yeah. They are dead pastors. Can you imagine yourself being spoken to by a dead man?
No.
But if God should open your spirit and your eye, or third eye, as I normally call, see somebody dead talking to you, you not even sit there. You go. You go and weep for him. And I've been seeing many of them.
Yeah. Wow. Interesting, viewers. This is another episode of our coverage discussing issues about Jesus Christ and then the instructions that God gave to Adam and flouted it, death, sin, and all that. That's why we are discussing on it. Elder, still on the death issue, how can I know that this man of God, so to speak, this Christian, brother or sister, is dead? Even though you've given us that when the presence of God leaves a person, or when the Spirit of God leaves a person, that person is dead. But how can a mere person know that this pastor, I am under his feet or her feet, is dead?
It's quite obvious. The Bible have said it. You know, to be a Christian is not a matter of how many times you come to church on Sundays, whatever, but how close you are with the Word of God. The Bible says by their fruit you will know them. By their fruit, you will know them. Pride is from who? Satan.
Satan.
If a pastor is proud, you can see a spirit has entered him. If a pastor or a church member or a Christian is materialistic, the Bible says, don't love the world or the things in the world. Anybody who loves these things, the glory of the Father is not in
him.
Only him. The person goes only after these things, then you can know. Nobody will put a mark there that I'm marking, but the word will, I mean, you put the word there, the person there, and you can see it.
Can wait, yeah.
Now, this person doesn't have God's spirit in him or in her. You can see by his actions. But somebody who is closer to the Lord, he lives by the Spirit. The Spirit lives in him. That's why the Bible says, live by the Spirit, so that you not conform yourself to the things of the flesh. Now, certain things that are flesh or carnal, that's what he yearns only after. Let's say there's a party going on in Amsterdam. He doesn't bother taking a train and go.
Yeah.
There's this one going there, he go. But let's say there's an all-night going, he'll never go. I don't have time, I'm tired. But if it was a party, he goes. He goes and puts himself up. But when it's all-night, he didn't go.
So
why?
It means that people of today love the world much better than...
Much more.
Their salvation.
Much more.
Amazing.
Let's go to our various homes. Everybody sleeps. How many of us wake up night to pray? Midnight prayer, how many of us? But let them have a movie. That's very interesting. They will sit down to midnight and watch it. How many? Meanwhile, the Spirit of God will prompt you. Is it not time for you to go and pray? Is it not time for you to pray or to read the Bible? I'm tired. I'm tired. I'm busy. Those things will choke in. A time will come, you yourself will diminish the spirit so much low, Jesus said, or Paul said, don't quench the spirit that is in you.
It's in you, yeah.
Spirit of fire to quench, and then he's gone. You become dead.
Yeah, you've come to another section of a very important issue about technology that you raised, that many of us can't even pray in the night. Many of us can't even develop ourselves always, but we have most of our time watching TVs, on our phones, Facebook? Is it killing us?
Personally, I call that the righteous idol worshippers. Mm-hmm. Righteous idol worshippers. They come to church on Sunday, they are righteous. They tie their hair with scarf, they pay their tithes, offerings, they do visitation. Everything that the righteous people do, they do. But when they are in free
method,
that is where their idol worshipping comes in. Now, idol worshipping is actually not a matter of going to cut a tree and carve it to be an idol and bow it down to it. But anything that you cherish much more than your God becomes your idol. Mm-hmm. It consumes much of your time. Mm-hmm. It consumes much of your energy. Mm-hmm. So let's say 24 hours a day. You spend 8 hours to sleep, mm-hmm. 8 hours to your work. Mm-hmm. The last 8 hours you do your daily chores. You have 4 hours on TV alone, computer, gadgets, and stuff. The whole 24 hour will pass without a Christian saying a prayer to God, looking into the Bible.
Very serious.
And by so doing, by the time will come that you will be depleted. Those things will consume much of your time, so much that you don't even have time even for your own self. You become a righteous idol worshiper. And that's what's happening these days.
This is very serious, Elder. I'm still interested in this because a lot of Christians, I don't know whether they know or whether they've been crowded with the things, the happiness in this world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, how would they know if somebody does not teach them? Mm-hmm. How would they know if somebody does not preach to them? Mm-hmm. I normally say that preaching will get you out of the world, but teaching will get the world out of you. Mm-hmm. Example, when Israel left Egypt, they had been there for hundreds of years. God miraculously took them by his righteous right hand from Egypt mm-hmm. to the promised land. On the way, they remembered against Moses and said, if you were in Egypt, but now we have eaten our cucumbers and our garlics. Where is it coming from? That Egyptian lifestyle was inside of them. So it took God to take the Egyptian destiny out of them. So their unbelief caused God to kill them on the desert. Come home. We are like that. We were in the world. The preaching on the radios, the preaching from a sermon from somebody that you heard, invitation from a friend, cause you to come from the world into Christ. But the worldly things are still in you. The Egyptology is still in you. It is good teaching. You know, Satan is not afraid of emotional preaching. Mm-hmm. So, what Satan fears most is teachings. Because when you teach somebody and he understands, that thing what becomes engraved in the person's heart, it takes on that thing again to take those things away from. Because when you preach, it's like talking, it goes there, it goes there. But when you come into one-on-one, you give people the chance to ask questions mm-hmm. that bothers them. You take your time to go down to their level and bisect and dissect the word to them. They absorb it wholly into them. And that, by so doing, it gets that word out of them. The only way to get away, to get rid of an old habit is to replace it with another habit. Understand?
Yeah.
So the church people who come here, they have come from the world, all right, but the world is still in them.
So a person would come to church or might come to church but still hold the old things in Egypt.
Yeah, still in them.
So how can we help these persons to...
By teaching.
By teaching.
If you look at what Jesus came to, did, to do,
yeah.
If you read through, Jesus taught many times than preaching.
Yeah.
Now, when he had multitudes, he normally preached to them.
Yeah, he said, yeah.
But with his disciples and close people, he taught them. Teaching means dissecting and letting people understand some reasons behind certain things. That's what you call teaching. Because somebody say Adam died, period. But it takes teaching for you to know what kind of death the person died.
Yeah.
You see, he died, but the person lived 930 years. This is not true. You throw the book away and go. Finished. Because the person doesn't have the chance and the time to know what kind of death are you talking about. Meanwhile, the person lived 930 years.
Elder, I want us to also focus on, you've given us who Jesus really is. But is he white? Is he black? Is he tall? Because when you tell me that I should believe in him and believe in his name, yet he tells me that when I does that, he will give me the authority to become son of God. So people are having a lot of problem who Jesus really is.
Okay.
Can you throw more light on before I come to my next question?
Like I said earlier, Jesus is God.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is God. And if you take Jesus out of the Bible, we have Quran.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is God, period. And nothing you can say or do can change my mind personally. But Jesus is God, in the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
You see, God we're talking about, he is spirit. Spirit, you can't see them. For God to manifest himself so that we can see him, he has to come in a man's form. So it all began Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. When he said, let us make man in our own image, God has an image. Okay. Now, for God to come so that we can have fellowship with him,
mm-hmm.
not in his pure state.
Yeah.
No, you can't.
Yeah.
He is too pure, his purity will consume you.
Yeah.
So I call it Trinity.
Mm-hmm.
Let's take water for example. Elder, if I pour water in your hand and I say, walk with this water in your hand to the train station,
mm-hmm.
how far will you go?
No.
Not any far. Yeah. Water in its original state, you can't hold it.
Yeah.
You can't fathom it.
It's shapeless.
It's shapeless, formless, whatever.
Yeah.
It takes the shape of whatever you put in.
Mm-hmm.
It takes the color of whatever color you put in. That's how God is, in his real state. Now, when God wanted us to have fellowship with him, feel him and touch him,
mm-hmm.
he kept himself in the womb of a virgin for 9 months. He was born, lived on earth for 33 and a half years. It's like the same water you put in a deep freezer. It becomes ice block.
Ice block.
When you get ice block, you can hold it. You can walk from here to the train station and come back with the ice block.
Mm-hmm.
Is the ice block still water?
Yes.
Good. That's why Philip asked him, you say you are going to the Father. Should ask the Father. He said, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father.
Mm-hmm.
If you see the ice block, you have seen the what? The water.
Now, so there's nothing like...
Please, one second.
All right.
Let me land.
Mm-hmm.
When he was going, he said, it's expedient for you that I go.
Mm-hmm.
If I don't go, the Holy Spirit will not come.
Mm-hmm.
So Jesus left, mm-hmm. the Holy Spirit came. Mm-hmm. What am I driving at? The same ice block, when you put into kettle,
mm-hmm.
you boil it, what comes out? Steam.
Steamy.
Or vapor.
Mm-hmm.
That's the Holy Spirit. That same water into ice block, into vapor, is still water. That's God in that dispensation.
So, God, as you said, appears in three ways.
He
manifests himself in three ways.
Yeah.
As the Father,
the Son,
as the Son,
and the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
And that is Jesus, so, the Son.
That is, viewers, the interpretation of... So God is not standing in A. Jesus is not standing here. Holy Spirit is not standing... But they are one. Right. But manifest... himself in three forms. That is what Elder has talked to us. So, why did he come to die?
Okay.
Why did Jesus come in the first place on earth?
Jesus came, or he came on earth, first of all, to announce God's kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
To bring back what we lost. Right now, if I see you coming from your house arts, your doctor, and you are carrying a bag,
mm-hmm.
written the prescription, paracetamol, or any painkiller you can name about. I know you have a headache or a pain. If I see you are holding tricylicate, I know you have a stomach problem. If I know you are holding insulin, I know you're having diabetes problem.
That forgot
you have headache or pain.
Yeah.
So what Jesus brought would tell us what we lost. Let's go back to Adam.
Mm-hmm.
When Satan, through his means, caused Adam to fall. Adam lost something. He lost the dominion power, the kingdom. Mm-hmm. That's what Jesus brought. So his first preaching statement in the book of Mark, he said, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And he said again, let me go to the nearby villages and preach the kingdom gospel to them, for that is why I was sent. Jesus emphatically said, that is why I was sent.
So the fundamental of his coming is to present to the world his kingdom.
Yeah. Even Isaiah prophesied it and said, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. There is a difference between the child and the son. I will come there later on. Now, his name shall be called the Wonderful, the Counselor, the Mighty God, his Father. His kingdom shall be on his way.
Show this.
So the kingdom, he came with it. He presented it.
Wow.
So his birth, his baptism, his burial, those things, they were all process. They were all a means to an end. Because the kingdom he's talking about, if you are not born again because Adam died, a dead person must be reborn. Otherwise, you cannot enter there. You need to be purified by his blood. Otherwise, you can't enter there. So the kingdom is a destination. And all the things he did was a preparation to get you there.
So Adam lost his kingdom.
Yeah.
So the world needed another kingdom.
We have it. We Christians, we have it.
So that's why he came and he carried the kingdom on his shoulder.
Isaiah prophesied it.
That's why, amazing.
When he was in front of Pilate, he said, Pilate said, don't you think I have the power to let you go? And he said, hey, that power you have, it was given to you from above. You said I'm a king. He asked him, he says, are you a king? He said, you said it. But my kingdom is not of this world. Otherwise, I will command legions of angels to come and I will wipe you off. He says, he's a king. We are not worshiping.
He has a kingdom.
He has a kingdom. So if you can read the Bible gradually, Jesus spoke about kingdom. Even the moment he resurrected, the Bible says he was teaching them about the kingdom of heaven. Jesus teaching was purely about the kingdom.
Yeah.
Edda, do you know when the end will come?
Not exactly.
Every Christian say, God did not say that, it's not in the Bible, but I know when the end will come.
Yeah.
Matthew 28, Jesus said, go and preach the kingdom of the gospel of the kingdom unto all the nations. And if as a testimony, and after doing that, then the end will come. You will hear earthquake. You will hear this, you hear those things have been happening.
So everybody who hears about the kingdom, then we are heading towards the end of the world.
The kingdom news must spread to everywhere. Otherwise, you won't come.
And then you said you want to expatiate the child and then the son.
Yes. Genesis 1:26, God said, let us make man in our own image. So, God is a spirit. John 4 says, God is a spirit. Therefore, those who worship God must worship in truth and in spirit.
Yeah.
God is a spirit. Now, Genesis chapter 2, the Bible says he formed man out of the dust. Genesis 1 says he created. Create in the Hebrew means bara, to form out of nothing. But in Genesis chapter 2, he made man from the dust, out of something. Good. And he breathed into him. So man has how many parts now? Two. His physical housing and a spirit inside. That will make you legal here on earth. Any spirit without a body is illegal.
Yeah.
It's illegal.
Yeah.
Good. So when Christ must come on earth, or God himself, he's a spirit.
Yeah.
Therefore, you need a body to dwell in. Otherwise, he become illegal. So, he sent an angel to Mary. He said, Mary, you're going to give birth to a son. Call his name Jesus. And Isaiah had already said, unto what a child is born.
Yes.
That good. That word Emmanuel. Im means in man. Man means mankind. El means Elohim.
Wow.
So, Emmanuel is Elohim inside man. So unto us a child is born. The child is the housing.
So the body houses the spirit.
That is the Jesus we are talking about. The body, as we sit here, is Jesus. But the spirit inside is Christ.
It's Christ.
So on the cross, who died? Christ did not die. Jesus' body died. A body dies.
Yeah.
Like, I'm sitting here, my body will one day die, but my spirit will still continue
that
to
live. That is why when they saw Jesus appeared, where they've got it, the disciples have got it.
They say,
and he's said, ghost. He said, it's a ghost.
He said, come and touch me and feel me. His flesh was there. So God is a God. He doesn't bypass his principles. The book of Proverbs says, many are the plans in a man's heart, but only my purpose will prevail. Stand. God's purpose stands as solid as a rock. For instance, we are going to Brussels. There's a blockage somewhere in the road, and we take a by street to get there. Has our destination changed? No, our purpose have no change. God might change the way he does things, but his purpose still remains the same.
That's good, Edda. And still, I want us to relate the sonship and the child issue to the kingdom. You said Jesus carries the kingdom. That is the basic purpose of his coming, to present his kingdom. Yeah. And who enters such a kingdom, a wonderful kingdom? And how can one enter such a wonderful kingdom? Who enters it? Can you help us with that? Or we can put it down and then discuss some other time.
Now, I'll give a hint on it. Then later we go inside it more.
Okay.
Now, God's kingdom is not a place where you need a passport or a visa. Mm-hmm. Good. His word is his visa. Mm-hmm. We were all of us once citizens of heaven. But we lost our citizenship through our grandfather Adam. So Jesus Christ has came back to give us the citizenship again. By what? By repenting. By accepting him. Believing in him. That's why the Bible says he came to his own. But his own did not accept him. But to them that believe in him, he gave them the power to become the children of God. God will not sit in heaven or in Brussels and watch his children sitting in Fimeswa, in somewhere village remote. God wants his children to come closer to him. So, the moment you believe him, accept him as your personal savior,
believe in his name also,
automatically you have crossed from, the Bible says, you have crossed from darkness into light, from death to life. As simple as that. You don't need to purify yourself and wash yourself with water or pray 10 times a day or face the east and pray. No. Just about belief.
Just believe and accept his name.
Yeah. The reason why this thing has become so, or certain things have become difficult for Christians to grasp and to embrace, is up to date, we don't know the fruit that Adam ate. People say he chopped guava. Mm-hmm. Others say orange. Mm-hmm. People say commonly apple. But if Christians nowadays know the kind of fruit that Adam ate, Christianity will be very easy.
Can you share with us?
Not today.
Not today. That would be another interesting topical issue, because I'm still curious to know the type of fruit that Adam ate. Yeah. Elder, it has been a wonderful time with us. But to finish our program, I want to ask this last question. The kingdom, if I presume, has some benefits, so that when we accept Christ and we believe in his name, then automatically we become sons of God. So what are the benefits in the sonship or in the kingdom of
God? In the kingdom of God, there is no sickness there. Mm-hmm. There is no crying there. Mm-hmm. Things we see as hardship, we don't have it there. The kingdom has a commonwealth. Like back in those days, Britain was a colonial master to Ghana. We could come from Ghana to Britain without a visa, because they are colonial masters. Yeah. And God's principal purpose was to rule this earth from an unseen world. Mm-hmm. So the earth is actually a colony to heaven. Mm-hmm. So if Ghana, for instance, is, we have everything we need.
Yeah.
Everything works perfectly according to the colony Britain.
Yeah.
You just have to take your passport and say, even passport, don't need it.
Yeah.
Go for vacation and come back. You will not struggle to get money to get ticket and visa and stuff, because the road is always open. The bond between Britain and Ghana is open. That's how it's supposed to be. Heaven was colonizing the earth. So if you ask, you wouldn't even be sick. Everything you need, the queen from England will supply it to Ghana. That's why up to now we still speak English.
English, yeah.
We go to school in shorts. That's what they do there.
Yeah.
We used to drive on the left-hand side. That's what they do in Britain. So the colony reflects on the main country. So heaven reflects earth character. That's God's main intention.
Yeah.
Now, it's to colonize. So when he says, when the colony system doesn't work, Jesus Christ came and said, wow, you people have lost something. The kingdom that you people are rejecting, there's no sickness there. You won't die. The sun shines 24/7. This is the place that God has prepared for you. That's what the Bible says. I have not seen, now had entered into the years and hearts of man, what God has prepared for those he loved. You see, it is amazing. So if Christians nowadays will make our life as Christ wanted to be, it's a perfect place to be the kingdom of God.
Wow.
But wow. Either, you know, there's a difference between heaven and the kingdom of God. There's a difference.
That would be another topical issue.
I tell you. Last time a friend of mine asked me, why are you so going to church and praying up and down? You don't go out. Your life is boring. I say, I want to see God. He said, you are mad. I say, yes. Righteous people will go to heaven. But pure people will go to the kingdom of God.
Wow.
Everybody is striving to go to heaven when you die. But mine is different. I want to see God. God, Jesus said in Matthew 5, blessed are the pure in heart. They shall see God. And even after Jesus' resurrection, the Bible says, after his resurrection, he went through the heavens. That means
so
after the heaven.
So many heavens.
He went through them. That means there's another place there. Bible says, nobody has ever seen God. He is light. He lives in a point where an immortal person cannot approach there. If you are not pure in heart, you can't. And that's where I am striving to be. Not just ordinary heaven. Ordinary heaven.
Amazing, incredible. Viewers, there is one of the wonderful episodes we've ever had to chat and to discuss with an elder. He always gives revelations and mysteries in scripture. Before we leave, I want him to give a word to all of us, what we must do as Christians in the Christendom, what we shouldn't do. That will be the last word for our guest tonight. Elder, can you give us one or two advice, even though we've elaborated a lot, but one or two issue for my cherished viewers?
Now, actually, there is more deeper things to go in, because if you want to talk about why Christ became a man, there's more into it.
Yep.
Because as God as he is, he loves us. Because God loves you. And if you look into the mirror and you see yourself, you like how beautiful you look, that is your image. So when God sees you, he sees his image. So anything that, for instance, you are looking in the mirror and the mirror is dirty, what do? You don't see your reflection well.
Yeah.
So you take something and you clean the mirror.
Wipe it, yeah.
Good. So when God sees you and he sees the image is blurred, is dirty, he take his son's blood, his own blood, and then wipe the mirror. Because he wants to see you as he is. First John said, just as Christ he is over there, so are we here.
Yes, well.
You see that? So when God sees you, he must see his image.
Yeah.
So if God does not see his image in you, there is something terrible. Why is it that, or what can prevent God from seeing you in his image? It's sin. Rebellion. The thing he says don't do, you do them. Anytime you do those things, you add dirty things on yourself. So when he looks at you, he doesn't see his image.
But see a different thing.
You see a different thing. But if you believe in Christ, in him, And then you apply his blood. You wipe yourself clean. You stay away from sin. The image becomes cleared. Mm-hmm. And when God sees you, he's happy. Can you imagine, Elder, that God himself will get out of his state, become your state, mm-hmm. in order to see you in him?
Wow.
It's love.
Yeah.
To the point of him becoming poor so that you will be rich. Mm-hmm. To the point of him dying so that you will live. Mm-hmm. To the point of him taking your pain so that you'll be painless. Mm-hmm. To the point of him carrying your disease so that you'll be whole again. Mm-hmm. It's amazing love. So, John 3:16, the Bible says, for God so loved the world. He didn't say he loved Christians. He loved the world. So this quotation actually is not for Christians.
It's for the world.
It's for the world. He loved them so much that he gave Jesus to them. That through his blood, the mirror will be wiped clean. That when he looks into you, he sees himself. God loves mankind so much. Otherwise, he will never become a man to go through what man is going through to save man. No, it's love, pure love. And this is what you call agape love.
Agape love.
You don't have to do anything to deserve it. He loves you just the way you are. You just have to say is, Father, I have come. Take me as I am. Clean me, wash me, purify me with your blood, and take me as your son again. He's always willing, ever ready. Mm-hmm. Remember the story about the prodigal son?
Yeah.
There's one thing that sometimes it annoys me, and most of the time I take the trouble to correct it. When I go to a place to preach or to teach and they introduce me as a servant of God, I don't stand actually in front of the congregation to readdress it. After that, I call the person who introduced me.
Yeah.
I'm not a servant.
Yeah.
I'll come to that point later. When the prodigal son came home, or when he was there, he said, how many servants do my father have? Many. They all eat and drink. I'm a son. Why should I be wasting my time in this place eating pig food? I'll rise back and go to my father. If I go, I will say, Father, take me as one of your servants. So he arose. He left. When the father see him or saw him coming from afar off, he ran and met him. The son knelt down. He was about to say, Father, take me. He said, shut up. Hey, kill the big fat bull. Put the ring on his feet, on his finger, and put a rope on him.
Wow.
My son was lost, but now he's found. The father didn't allow him to use the word servant, because
well,
he is still a son.
Yeah.
So imagine your son priest,
king priesthood.
Now he has grown to be a fine gentleman. Say, Father, I don't want to be your son anymore. I don't want to eat at the dining table. I want to sit at the gate with the watchman, and I'll sleep in the. Well, how would you feel? He's demoting his state from sonship. Then all these things I have acquired, lands and cars and buildings, who am I supposed to give to? If you refuse to be my son and be a servant, no, you're not a servant, you are still my son. That's how God wants us to be. The Bible says, to them who believe in him, he gave them the power. That word power is rights, inheritance. To be God's son or God's child is something that is the highest you can ever attain. Mm. And then you have to address me as a servant. Am I Elijah or Elisha or Jeremiah?
I'm a son of God.
I'm a son of God. I'm not a servant of God. I'm a son. Of God. Because I have received. No, Jesus Christ lost something on this world. People don't know. We normally say that Jesus Christ is the only son of God. Mm. He lost that title. He is the only begotten son of God. But he's not the only son of God.
Yeah.
The moment he died and he resurrected, he get a new title, the only begotten of the dead.
Yeah.
From there, we all become God's sons.
So we've been adopted.
That's it. So in God's kingdom, his children are there. No servants are there. So if you want to count yourself out, it's up to you. But as for me, I'm his son, I'm his child, I am his kingdom.
Cherished viewers, that is our elder. Don't be a servant, but be a son. There are some certain benefits a son gets, but a servant does not. Where do you belong? A sonship or a servantship? I would want Elder to pray for us. And we pray that In our subsequent coverages, we will deal with issues that will rise from this. Let me tell you, we've discussed who Jesus is. What did he come to do? The reason why he came. The next meeting of our thrash out of interrogation, we will tackle the events that surrounds Jesus' stay here on earth. And by the time we are through with this episode, it will help you to know the truth. And when you know the truth itself shall set you free. Until we meet for another episode, enjoy the peace of God and let the refreshing of Him always be in you. Thank you very much, and may God richly bless you. But before we go, I will let Elder pray for all of us. Elder, the camera is yours.
Most High God, Father, we thank you. We bless your holy and righteous name.
Amen.
For a time like this, you said in John 6:63 that the spirit quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing.
Yeah.
The word that I speak to you are spirit and they are life.
Yeah.
Your word that came through me is not my word. They are spirit and they are life.
Yo.
Let anyone who is not under the sound of my voice have life in him.
Amen.
Even though he might be dead like Adam was dead, even though he might be a walking dead, the moment he or she receives or hears your word you are speaking through me tonight or today to the person who have heard me, life will start coming up in that person, wherever that person is, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I release the anointing of the Lord upon you.
Jesus.
I transfer you from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son, according to Galatians 1:13. You are no more a servant. You are a child.
Amen.
A one and only child of the Most High God. He has bought or purchased you with his precious blood. Now you are no more belong to the devil, but you belong to him.
Amen.
Now I pray that day by day time that we meet again, you have the supernatural encounter with our Lord.
Amen.
May his face shine upon you.
Amen.
May his countenance be risen up on you.
Amen.
May he give you peace in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And God bless you.
God bless you too.
For inviting me here.
And then you are mostly welcome. And I guess, and I understand that we're going to also have one of the finest interactions subsequently. So thank you very much for your time, because we've exhausted enough of his time. Viewers, we thank you and we love you. Can you extend your greetings to your family? Or it's very important.
My greetings to all my family, my children from both far and near. I'm international man, so I have children everywhere in the world. Adopted children, grandchildren, my own flesh and blood. I love you all, and may God cause his face to shine upon you. Amen.
Amen. And then I also love you, my parents back in Ghana, my wife, Jeanette, and my boy, King Priesthood. I love you, and God bless you. Stay blessed.
Thank you.
Amen.
Bye-bye.
Bye.